Elias and all the Northern organization, particularly Johan, for all this exciting workshop. And today I'm just introducing you, trying to, you know, give you some clues. This talk is especially prepared for early career scientists, because I want to transmit our passion for astronomy and for space exploration, give you some examples, and also, well, trying to, let's say, teach some tips, no, for interesting, for getting really progress in this fascinating world of space exploration from a point of view, as a starting point of view. In this first slide, I will just exemplify that if one thing is space exploration, is probably follow the dream, because you know, in every step, in every solve equation, in every instrument that has been developed in order to get make real some of these dreams, we really get progress, no? And part of this progress can be finally, you know, in our day-to-day life. As a summary of the talk, just explaining a few things about working in the space sector from a very basic early career scientist perspective. I will give you some examples about the relevance and intrinsic challenges of space exploration, focusing this in my research topics concerning minor bodies. And then I will also just give you some advice concerning the master thesis, what is it and how to deal with it. And defining a research topic for a master dissertation. I will just give three basic first advices: finding a right advisor, defining a viable topic, and work hard on it to grow as a scientist. Because master dissertations, in fact, is the way in which we can grow as a person and scientist. Of course, all this requires to choose. All the time we are choosing, as some of my colleagues say before. We need to choose the right environment, research center, and advisor. But we also need to know how to develop a master thesis, a good dissertation. And in that sense, I will give you some tips to build your master thesis concerning the general structure, the sections, and the strength of this master thesis. I will also explain some things about peer review process, that sometimes are, well, these kind of topics that are, well, you don't know much more about. And then explain how to transform the master thesis in a research article. Also trying to search for the right job. If something is space exploration, is well, you know, the way in that you have a really multidisciplinary environment involving several sciences and techniques, mainly astronomy and astrophysics, but also space technology, so scientists and technical people are working together. Until recently, the access to space required huge amounts of money to be spent, so it was only accessible to large space agencies and very big companies. But you know, new space agencies and private companies are coming out. And this is a consequence of the growing, it's a growing sector that in which the miniaturization of the instrumentation has also brought the democratization of space. It introduces in opportunities to work for early career scientists, and all this also produces spins of technology with potential application in our everyday life. So, concerning space exploration discoveries, I think we can put some examples. Current exploratory missions give us absolutely new opportunities. In fact, new ways to see completely different environments in the solar system. Humans in space require life support, so complex systems need to be installed in the spacecraft or in the new settlements. And in that sense, the construction of lunar and Mars bases in the future to be really viable, we require to develop new techniques. Just to give some two key techniques that must be developed in the next future is these techniques that allow us to use the in-situ resource utilization, how to deal with the minerals that are in these settlements, and from these minerals get the resources we really need. Another example will be just developing instrumentation and techniques to work under low gravity conditions, so we can go to explore not only the moon, also really small asteroids as well. So just to put some examples of the recent exploration of asteroids and comets, I'm just giving the down mission of NASA as an example. As you probably know, if you have used sometimes one telescope, you have had the chance to see through a telescope. For even the largest asteroids, as are Vesta and Ceres, all these objects are just like stars in our telescopes. To get real images, real knowledge about how these bodies are, you really need to prepare missions, spacecrafts, to go and rediscover all these objects. We can transform with these space missions distant points of light into real bodies to explore, with amazing implications for our knowledge of the solar system, or even to our life in the future, because some of these spin of values can be applied to the future as well, particularly when we deal, for example, with all these in situ research utilization techniques that can be applied also to our planet. Vesta is this kind of body with a diameter of 525 kilometers that exhibits clues about really important igneous activity in these large asteroids, just close to the limit, almost in the limit of a planetary body, but that has been also suffering large collisions over time. Thanks to Dawn and some of this really amazing instrumentation, state-of-the-art instrumentation, we can really reconstruct the history of our solar system and all these processes that were happening in these bodies since their formation. You can imagine that this is not a point of light. This is a real world discovered, or let's say rediscovered, by down the spacecraft. In the same time, just after being, you know, orbiting Vesta, down the spacecraft was going to make a approach to Ceres. That is also a priority target in the space exploration. It's a fascinating body from an astrobiological point of view. Thanks to all these maneuvers that made down, we got exciting imagery and instrumental data that supports the presence of volatile materials in the surface with the outgassing that probably suggests some type of cryovolcanism. In fact, the Ceres is emitting about 6 kilograms of water per second, as discovered Michael Cooper's and collaborators in 2013 using Hubble Space Telescope that data. And you know, in fact, Ceres compared with the Earth has much water. In proportion. So, moreover, when we study carbonaceous condites in our laboratories, we really understand that having rock samples from Ceres is crucial to our understanding of the evolution of the of this, let's say, wet planetary embryos. Because this is even in the size of what we consider a planetary body, because Ceres is the largest asteroid in the solar system and has more than 970 kilometers in diameter. So interesting that because of that, we have proposed the mission Gauss to get a sample return mission from Ceres as well. And you can enjoy this open access article that has been recently published in Experimental Astronomy and has a lot also of outreach about these objects, and I particularly recommend it. On the other hand, we also have the DART NASA mission, in which I'm happy to be involved, that is going to achieve the first in situ test of kinetic deflection around September 22, 2022. This system, the Didymos system, is formed by one main asteroid of 800 meters and a satellite of about 160 meters. And particularly, DART spacecraft is conceived to collide with Dimorphos in order to perform the first test that we can later measure the change in the orbital period of Dimorphos. So this can at the same time be reinforced by a following mission that is called HERA, in which the European Space Agency tries to study the consequences and the structure of this binary system. You know, it's really exciting having these missions going on. And in fact, with this one, we will learn how to deflect an asteroid and the direct application that can be applied to hazardous objects. And these are the kind of missions in which you really learn a lot of things. For the moon and the asteroids, a lot of things are going on in their surfaces. There is a overall process that is, you know, it's called space weathering, that is producing comminution of the regolith surface. These rocks that are covering the surface as consequence of so many impacts and so many materials going back to the body makes that as consequence of continuous collisions, thermal stress with the changes in temperature or even micrometeoritic bombardment, that all these materials are grinded over time. At the same time, all these materials are in movement, because the full body, the entire body, Eros is a kilometer size, is a few tens of kilometer size body. Itokawa is about, in the major axis, 400 meters. You know, you have this low gravity, low escape velocity conditions, a much higher thermal inertia as consequence of all these collisions and this compaction of some of the materials, and direct solar wind interaction, which is also challenging as well. So asteroids get smaller, and low gravity allows this large ejecta debris to escape. Really, you have a really complicated environment to learn about. Another challenging, and I'm just finishing with these few examples, challenging mission was Stardust. I was lucky to be in US at the time Stardust preliminary examination team was going on. So I had the opportunity to participate in the study of the deceleration of the particles in the aerogel and the study of the chemistry of all these materials. We got, thanks to a very, very amazing system, thousands of particles of this comet recover, as you can see here on the left side, these bulbous tracks that were produced by the deceleration of the particles at the fragmentation of the particles when penetrating in this collector, in the aerogel that was in this honeycomb-like collector, in which the particles, as you can see below in the tracks, were stopped in a few millimeters from 6.1 kilometers per second to zero, and were, of course, in the interior of this aerogel, silicon dioxide aerogel, were stuck and recovered and brought back to Earth. In fact, the Stardust mission is another really nice example of that. And this is going on now. And thanks to all the experiments that we are performing in our laboratories, really more exciting missions will come out. And I want, first of all, try to be inspirational in that, in this talk, because you can also form part of all this research in space exploration. Well, first of all, we need to deal a little bit about the master thesis. How to define the research topic? A master thesis work will be possibly your first research work. You need to understand that, it's very important. You need to undertake it with curiosity and interest. Choose an attractive topic, easy to undertake. And that's also very important tip. Because it will serve to complete your master's degree after the dissertation, but also it teaches you to propose and structure a scientific work. At the same time, you will realize, if you collaborate with a team, at least with your advisor, that science today is collaborative. So you need a really positive, constructive environment. And once you get this environment, just go for it. Because if you work hard on it, to make a very good master thesis, that therefore has potential to bring you to prepare your first scientific publications as well. And that's also a message to bring back. No? In that sense, if you want to define the research topic, when related to space research, just try to get advice of experts, even from your advisor, because you need to choose a topic that arouses curiosity allows you to learn, to discuss a modern aspect in which you can offer an overview on the physical chemical processes that shape particular object or research, and then compare with the observations and studies carried out in the scientific literature. So you need to become at a certain point like an expert of that specific point in which you are concentrated for some months, sometimes half a year, 1 year, to complete your masterclass. Be aware also that it must be a realistic project. You, depending on the time you need to complete this this work, you really need to perhaps learn the way in just concentrating one aspect. And you will realize how difficult science is, because probably in this process you will find many other open questions that you will even not even never able to answer. But well, it's the way the science is. It's very important that you're willing to accept the opinion, advice, and guidance of the advisor to improve your methods, develop the experimental and observational parts of the work, and be able to complete the master work on time. In that sense, as I said before, it should be the most important work accomplished by a skilled person. So with the skill of a master, and this work by itself should be a masterpiece. Just to choose the director, I just put here two persons that means so much for me. I mean, I was almost in shock when they had the opportunity to meet Lynn Margulis and Professor Joan Oro when I was really young in Valencia when I was born. And really, I understand that if you want to make a progress in science, you really need to be involved in a team that is also inspirational for you. Particularly an active, a skilled researcher with experience in a research field chosen, with being a close, a friendly person, available for questions and suggestions, and trying to ask and expect to a certain extent, he proposes you a direct interaction with his or her team. So it will give chances to learn and publish the work if it is really of relevance. At the same time, particularly, you know, young people nowadays is not like in my epoch. I mean, we were a little bit afraid of traveling, sometimes not so quite insecure, at least in my case. But nowadays there is this globalization. Let's see how it evolves. But you have possibilities to get access to centers and know people that can act as thesis advisors. Try to get a center of scientific excellence and specialize in the topics that focus your master dissertation. And preferably you can visit it to know how it works. Just try to request having at least some degree of freedom to choose the master topic, even of course you need to follow the topics that your advisor proposed. And of course, a place, a location, a research environment in which you can have the opportunity to collaborate in the future and allow you to grow scientifically. I will go now quite fast over the master dissertation structure. Nowadays, there are two widely accepted options to present your master work. There is a recent way in that you can write your master as a research paper. Of course, you need to have some skills, particularly, to summarize all the things you are doing in a master thesis in a paper. For me, it's too extreme. Let me say that I really like the old memory, like minor thesis manuscript, no? Because it has this kind of common structure of about 30 pages. This can be changing from 50 to 20. All this depends of the university and country. But this is the kind of structure that they will go over the next slides. And you will find introduction where you discuss the literature and you are just including your objectives, your goals for the master work, the experimental instrumental procedure, the results, the discussion, conclusions, and bibliography. As I said, this is the exact size of this memory. It will change depending of the place where you are working on that. So let's go over the structure of your master thesis. In the introduction, I'm thinking to get a document of about 25-30 pages. In this introduction, you need to raise the problem you intend to solve, introduce the current stage of the problem and the most relevant literature that of course requires reading a lot. I will say just at least get all the seminal papers that are dealing with the topic you have chosen. And then you need to be at least 1-2 months reading and taking notes of what has been done to really have the opportunity to bring novelty to your work. Then establish an appropriate line of argument. Now that you already know about the literature and you can introduce the steps, because science goes in steps, not all are going in the same direction. Sometimes you need to go back and recalculate everything. But you know, it's very important that you establish a guidelines and clearly propose the objectives of the master thesis at the end of this introduction. Sometimes well, this is of course approximate, no? But you can get work on this in a extent of 5-10 pages. Everything depends a little bit about the global extent, and this should be a clear text without rambling. Then we go to the experimental procedure, where you propose the techniques and procedures that will be used to obtain the results. You need to describe carefully the instrumentation used, because one of the main aspects of your science should be, you know, it should be reproduced for anyone. So you need to give all details about the particular techniques and theoretical basis of what you are doing. Just try to list in detail the observational and experimental conditions so they can be reproduced independently by others, and briefly present a result to explain this obtainment. In this case, this experimental procedure should be a little bit brief, that a few pages, 2 to 5 pages, depending on the complexity of the techniques and so on. Then you need to start to write the results, and the section of results should be results, no discussion or divagation about the data, no. Just present the results clearly and in a succinct way, either showing them in graphs or tables. Establish a continuum with the previous section, making clear the techniques and main procedures used, clearly define the magnitudes and errors corresponding to the measures that you have done in your lab or with your telescopes or whatever instrumentation you use, properly list the results and put them briefly in context, identifying what is really novel in your research. This is directly can be said very briefly and then discussed in the following section. Should be a section quite schematic and to the point. And of course, depends on how many results, how is the amount of data that you are dealing with, that it can go to 5-10 pages. But of course, you don't need to put there everything. If some of the data you know are redundant, you can try to define a glossary and then bring some of the tables or data or images to the end of the work, because it should be a work that can be easily readable, yeah, in that sense. So as the next section, the discussion, try to comment the results obtained and compare them with those previously obtained in the scientific literature. You should try to establish a line of argument there and directly related to the previously set objectives. Remember, at the beginning of the work, at the end of the introduction, so you can introduce your own interpretation and phenomenology under study and compare it with that developed by other colleagues, properly citing those key sources. And then put the results in context with the greatest possible depth. That could be 5-10 pages long. And finally, the conclusions that introduce where you should go to the point as well. You can introduce these conclusions with a couple of short paragraphs with clear statements on the things you have really achieved. And it should be your conclusions, your science, your results, not the results of other people. Here is not the place to put your citations. The citations should be put in the introduction, in the discussion mostly, but not in your conclusions. And then after this few, a couple of paragraphs where you have just, you know, introducing your main results, then you can list a series of clear and very concise points that will be the real conclusions of your study. What you have really bring to this topic, and you need to make clear that these are really novel aspects that you have introduced to this research field. Clearly, you can separate the results and interpretation of ones from those previously obtained. That's very important. And always trying to use brief sentences with the reason argument. It's good to invest the maximum effort and time and do not ramble in your writing. And of course, as I said, as if this conclusion should be your conclusions, do not use of other people's cues, because you need to get your own results. And here, typically, a master thesis shouldn't be more than 1-2 pages. Okay, and then we go over the last part of the talk that is going to deep into science dissemination. Scientific research has significant implications for science and its connection with the society. Lately, several research areas have started to spread widely thanks to open access. And now there is this driving force in the scholarly publishing industry, this transition to open access that, in fact, is because there is a continuous demand of accessibility by the society. However, libraries, funders, and government agencies have their own policies. So let's see how it works, the science dissemination, and particularly what means publishing under peer review. First of all, your research will be validated by experts in your field. So it's what really get important, what you did in particular in your master thesis. It will be the right way to disseminate your research. As the science requires validation, new papers must be arbitrated. You need to get the opinion of experts, editors, and reviewers. And of course, acceptance of a paper should require a level of quality and novelty, is what I said before. You need to concentrate. Well, scientific publication will serve to culminate your master's degree, so work hard for it. And at the same time, preparing a paper teaches you how to propose, search for clues, argument, and structure a scientific work. So it's really a step forward for your career. And then you need to dedicate time for it. Of course, to produce new research usually requires collaboration with a team and a research center university. If you are positive, making a good master work, this publication effort can lead you to get your first scientific publication. And the thing is, if you prepare a memory for this master thesis work, the good news is that the typical sections for a scientific paper are not so different. But in any case, you will require work a lot in the synthesis and careful preparation of the text, of the manuscript. And of course, you cannot end a scientific manuscript, particularly when you are starting in science, and going to 30 pages. It could be really crazy. But you need to try to synthesize this master thesis work in about 10 pages, let's say. And then following this kind of a structure, you can get the paper done. Well, in reference to choose the research topic, you should read the literature, as I said, and establish some goals. Of course, if you have already made a master thesis, you already know in that specific topic the scientific literature, so you have something, a win-win situation, no? So you can summarize better what is known about this topic. If you choose a hot topic in which you really got a real contribution, and this doesn't need to be the entire master, if not only one part of the master, for example, then perhaps you can start publishing this really exciting result before the rest of it. Be aware that it must be a self-consistent topic, providing an updated view of the research, and you need to accept the opinion, advice, and guidance of the referees that the journal chooses to review your app. In general, I put here some ideas about choosing the right journal, you know, basic idea, a referee and competent journal, a journal being a clear reference, having a good impact index. In our case, for example, our research center imposed us to work in first quartile, but an early career scientist sometimes tries to publish in a second quartile, for example, or something like that. It depends, of course, of the advice that the experts tell to them. What does it mean, the quartiles? The quartiles are in reference to the number of journals you have. Here, for example, in the astronomy and astrophysics, We have around 30, little more than 30 journals. And here you have the first quartile, the Q1, as you can see here, of astronomy and astrophysics journals. So these are the papers that have been that are having high number of sites. And then to publish in these journals give you additional value. Concerning the scientific publication, you need to know that this is preceded by a peer review system that aims to guarantee the quality and good practices of articles published in peer review. And here is the full pathway that is followed. When the article reaches the editor, he will possibly evaluate by himself the paper, and then can contact with associate editors that finally decide if bring the article to peer review or not. The peer review process, in fact, need to start by double checking the novelty and plagiarism in the paper. But this is a task made by the also with the associate editors and the staff of the journal. And if the paper is of quality, is sent to reviewers. These referees, in fact, after reading the manuscript, prepare a report. They can accept, suggest significant changes or reject the manuscript, and the associate editors are deciding in view of these decisions, no, of the different reviewers that are experts in the field. So peer review evaluation is also an excellent way to explain how the science works. In this diagram, you can start in describe, raise the problem, going then right to scientific results, then paper submission to a scientific journal, then paper publication, then accepted knowledge. And at the end of all this chain, you have that from the knowledge of the disciplines, some of this knowledge can go to teaching of the research discipline and go to the public knowledge. This is really important. I can dedicate half an hour to discuss this diagram, but I have no time, so I'm going to just almost finishing my presentation. All this is an iterative process. Once submitted, the editors have a key role and decide about what is going on in that sense. In general, not only the quality is important, but it must also meet the length, format, and subject required by the journal. And in general, all this peer review procedure can help you to keep learning. That's the idea. The people that start submitting manuscript learn that the publishing is really tough many times and requires always listening and be able to listen to experts and to be, in that sense, able to understand your own fails. This is the institute where I work with some of the main lines that we are working on. And particularly, I want to say that you can get here in these homepages additional information. Be particularly aware that we are now hiring PhD and postdoc opportunities, already posted in our homepage. And we are also teaching a Master Cosmos Barcelona in English and also I'm also teaching a master degree in Spanish by the Universidad Internacional de Valencia. And well, I just wish all of you good luck and thanks for listening.